Paul Comfort, tell us all about Maryland transportation.
Good evening. How y'all doing? This is like church. Everybody's sitting back three rows. You know, when you're up here, you really notice it. So I got to tell you, hearing Tim and Jim talk, Queen Anne's County is very lucky to have leaders like this. I go all over the state in my role, and I can tell you, Queen Anne's County is lucky to have dedicated officials, public officials like Jim Moran, and knowledgeable, who really know their stuff. And we're very fortunate. I feel great having someone like him as the at-large commissioner for Queen Anne's County. I served with him for 6 months at the beginning of this last term, and then was selected by Governor Hogan to head up something called the Maryland Transit Administration. So I'm gonna talk to you some tonight about what MTA is, how it affects Queen Anne's County, and then give you a little bit of the big picture of transportation in Maryland, which I think you might be interested in. My background is I've lived in Queen Anne's County since I was a kid. Grew up on Kent Island. My dad was Reverend William Comfort, who had a church here in the county. And got married here, moved to Sudlersville, lived there for 12 years, then moved out to Roosburg for 8 years. And during that time, went to college here. In 1987, when I graduated from college, the county commissioners chose me to be their first transportation coordinator. So I worked for the Department of Aging right here in this town, worked in several offices where the Arts Council is today, down where the Centerville Police Department is, out at the Kramer Center. Those are all my offices as we moved around for 7 years as the county's transportation coordinator. And then I was asked to start a public bus system for the county, so we started County Ride, which is still here today. It's considered one of MTA's locally operated transit services that we help fund, and I'll tell you a little bit about that later. And then I became, I went into our County Ride service back in 1991, won an award. It was the Community Transportation Association of America gave County Ride the award as the best small transit system in America. And through that, I met some people, and they invited me to come work for them. So I went all around the country for about 10 years, working for big private companies, starting up transit systems. We would come in and bid on running a transit system for a city or a county, and then get it set up, and I'd go to the next deal. Went to law school during that time, then came back, and what did I do then? I think I went to work for Yellow Transportation in Baltimore, Yellow Cab, Yellow Bus, and they wanted me to help them take their company national to win contracts around the country. So I did that, and then they sold the company to a big French company. I left and became county administrator here in Queen Anne's County. So I served two sets of commissioners, left on the second group as I was recruited by Charles County, Maryland. I went there to become their county administrator. We moved there for 5 years to the day. I moved there on Father's Day 1 year, and 5 years later, on Father's Day, I moved back. It was just weird how it worked out. It was like a chapter in my life turning, Fred was a big part of me coming back, to be honest with you. He kept begging me to come back. And, this is our home, so we moved back here 5 years ago, this June, and ran for county commissioner, and was blessed to run and win with a bunch of great guys. I think we got a lot accomplished in the first 6 months, and they continue to do tremendous work. So then Governor Hogan called me and said, Paul, you're the perfect person to head up the MTA. You have run transit systems around the country. You know a lot about transit. You've run big government agencies. You've been Queen Anne's County Administrator and Charles County Administrator. You're a lawyer, and you're a little bit of a politician. And that's exactly what we need to be the head of the MTA. So the MTA is a big agency. It's actually the fifth largest state agency out of all the state agencies, bigger than most of the cabinet departments. We've got 3,300 employees and about 2,000 contractors that work for us full time. So we have 5,000 people. I have an $820 million operating budget and a $3.5 billion capital budget that's over 6 years. We call that our consolidated transportation plan. And we're not just Baltimore City's transit system, although that's the biggest part of what we do. Most cities in America have a transit system. Most of them are set up with boards of directors, like WMATA. When I walked in today, the CEO of WMATA called me, Paul Wiedefeld. I haven't called him back yet because we're sitting back there. But so WMATA is what we meet and talk a lot. No, that's not what it means. That's what I worked there for 5 years, what it seemed like it meant. But it's the Washington Metropolitan Area Transit Authority. And so that's a standalone agency. Here in Maryland, we do it differently. In Maryland, we're part of the executive branch of government. So I work for a guy who's the Secretary of Transportation. His name is Pete Ron, a great guy. He's been secretary in two other states, New Mexico and Missouri. And now he's got a third state here in Maryland. And our agency is one of six modes. or six business units that are under the Maryland Department of Transportation. You might remember a guy named Governor Marvin Mandel. And there was a guy named Harry Hughes, who was from the Eastern Shore, from Denton. Harry Hughes became the first Secretary of Transportation of Maryland. And they decided to try to combine all of these transportation modalities into one group to see if we could get some synergies. So they brought together the Port of Baltimore, the airport, what's called the Maryland Aviation Administration. They run BWI Marshall Airport and also Martin State Airport and help oversee all the airports in Maryland, including our Bay Bridge Airport. They help provide funding and things like that to that. And then the MTA. We had all been standalone agencies, and they brought us all together. And then that combined with State Highway Administration that you've heard about tonight. They're the ones that run all the numbered roads in Maryland. Easy way to remember it. And then the MDTA, which Commissioner Moran spoke about, they're basically Maryland's toll authority. A lot of times they get confused with my agency, the MTA, because there's only one letter difference. MDTA, the Maryland Transportation Authority, and MTA, Maryland Transit Administration. But as Commissioner Moran said, they have their own budget that's not pulled from the Transportation Trust Fund. It instead just comes from their tolls. And those monies, like he said, are used for maintenance and things like that in all of their facilities, all the toll facilities in Maryland. And then, of course, the MVA, the Motor Vehicle Administration, is the sixth group. So the six of us all report to Pete Ron. We meet every Monday morning to something called the Secretary's Cabinet Meeting. I sit with all of them, as well as the deputy secretaries and things like that. We talk about what's happening in the state of Maryland, all the latest big projects at each of our business units. And we're all funded, the five of us outside MDTA, we're all funded by something called the Transportation Trust Fund, which is made up primarily of your gas taxes. When you go and pump up a gallon of gas, some of that goes to the state of Maryland. The rest of the money comes from a little bit of corporate income tax. And then, of course, the monies that come in there come in from the port, which makes money, the airport, which makes money, and MVA, Motor Vehicle Administration, for all your titling fees and tags. And when you register a vehicle, you have to pay sales tax on that. All that goes into this big trust fund. It's billions of dollars. And then that money split up among the five business units of the Department of Transportation. So that's kind of how that works, and that has to be approved by the Maryland General Assembly. They vote on our budget. The governor proposes the budget because we're part of Governor Hogan's government, and then the General Assembly has to adopt that budget. But it doesn't come from the money that funds all of ours comes from just the trust fund. It doesn't come from the general fund. As a matter of fact, there was a vote a few years ago across the state of Maryland to keep that money in what they call a transportation lockbox, because that money was evidently being taken for other purposes that weren't in transportation. So now it all stays just in that transportation trust fund. At the MTA, we get most of our money from that, but we also get 25% of our funds from fares, people that ride our buses and ride our trains. They pay a fare to ride, and so that funds about 25% of our budget. And then we get a big hunk of the money from the federal government. So Fred wanted to talk about taxes tonight and money, so that's a little bit how we're funded. So what is the MTA? So we provide multiple services, and some of it affects Queen Anne's County. So we are the Baltimore region's transit system. We operate the public bus service. I have 750 buses, 1,200 drivers, four big garages in Baltimore. We run the bus service for Baltimore County, Baltimore City, and Northern Anne Arundel County. We also have a subway system in Baltimore. A lot of people don't know that, but we do. Our bus service, we have about 250,000 people a day that ride our bus service, 250,000 passengers every day. And then the next mode down from that is our subway system. We have 40,000 passengers a day. Then we also run a light rail system. You may have ridden that. That actually is a big draw for people to go up to Camden Yards. You might remember Governor Schaefer, wanted to make sure that we got the light rail open the first day Camden Yards was open, and it did. That was the first day. My deputy administrator is the one that was in charge of building the light rail at the time. His name is Suhair Al-Khatib, a great guy, and he still works for us. And he's the lead engineer on now developing something called Maglev, which is magnetic levitation train between Baltimore and Washington, D.C. We won a $28 million federal grant to study that. It is amazing. I rode the Maglev when Fred and I went to China. We rode the Maglev train at Shanghai. It goes 300 miles per hour. It's amazing. And so the Japanese government is interested in helping fund a Maglev train between Washington and Baltimore as the first leg of eventually going all the way to New York City. So there would be a 300 mile per hour train that would make the commute between Washington and Baltimore 15 minutes. It would just be amazing. And the state is not putting any money into this. It's all coming from federal dollars that are awarded, and also they're looking for private sector involvement. There's a big group of big money people behind it, including Kevin Plank, the guy that owns Under Armour in Baltimore and all that, and they're very interested in this as the next phase of what public transit might look like. It wouldn't be surprising, they're saying, if a lot of the airlines didn't invest in this, because this the Northeast Corridor is a big part of their how they make money. They fly planes back and forth between D.C. and New York and all that. So that's another project we're working on. So we run the bus, the subway system, the light rail system. We have about 25,000 passengers a day on that. And then we run mobility service, which is what a lot of my background is in, which is van service for people with disabilities, the elderly, disabled. And we are now the fourth largest paratransit system in America. I transport 10,000 people every day. Go to the front of their house. We have a driver walk up to the door, help them come out, set them in their, if they're in a wheelchair, lock it all in and take them to their appointment. It's called ADA, Americans with Disabilities Act. It's a civil right. And if they live within a quarter mile of either side of any of our bus, light rail, or subway lines, we'll pick them up. They call and make an appointment. We'll pick them up and we'll take them where they got to go. We'll pick them up and bring them back home. It's a great service for people, very similar to what Queen Anne's County offers through County Ride. So those are the four main services in the Baltimore area. Then we have MARC commuter train. You may have heard of that. This is a service that has real locomotives, like a real train system. And we transport around, I think that service is 35,000 passengers a day. So this is three main lines. It runs from Northeast Maryland down to Penn Station, down to Union Station in D.C. It stops at a couple places along the way. So all three of our lines have as their terminus Union Station in Washington, D.C. Another line comes up to Camden Yards. That's called the Camden Line. The other one's called the Penn Line. And then the last one is called the Brunswick Line, and that runs from Union Station all the way up through Western Maryland out to Brunswick, Frederick, Brunswick, and then to Martinsburg, West Virginia. I've ridden it right to the end and looked at all the stations along the way. Really cool. We are like what came from the B&O Railroad. That Camden Station is where B&O Railroad, the first big railroad in America, started. My office is in the William Donald Schaefer Tower. That's right in the middle of town. And right next to me is the old B&O building. They've got a B&O restaurant. It's phenomenal, the history that's there. So we run that service as well, and that's mostly for commuters, people riding into D.C. to work, about 35,000 people a day. So overall, we have 380,000 passengers every day that ride those six services, 111 million passengers a year. We're the 11th largest transit system in America. And so that's our service. I've been spending a lot of time focused on providing what I call our four North Stars. When I got there, I'm going to tell you, the MTA... Governor Hogan told me when he appointed me to the job, he said, Paul, this is one of the toughest state agencies in Maryland to run efficiently. So I gave us four North Stars: safe, efficient, reliable transit across Maryland with world-class customer service. And everything we do has to be focused on that. So I put in place key performance indicators. I fired a bunch of people they left. And we brought in a bunch of new managers, many of them from the private sector who understand the pressure to operate within a budget. The MTA had never stayed on budget for 12 years. This year, for the first year in 12 years, we're in the black, we're on budget, we're not overspending. They didn't have the tools. They were not even measuring. The managers didn't know what their budgets were. I mean, it was just a mess, Jim. You would believe it. So we've got them all now, monthly, what we call in the private sector, a P&L, profit and loss. It's their monthly financial statement. I meet with them every month and grill them on their budget and make sure they stay within budget. We have financial analysts now that meet with them and explain to them how the budget works. On the operations side, we're now reporting to them what our on-time performance is, what our accident rates are, AFR. I've got finally an app on our phone for our managers where they can look and see what their on-time performance is right now on the bus service, right now on light rail, right now, so they can do right now management. When I got there, I kid you not, they were not sending managers the on-time performance except once a month, and they were trending it. So how could managers manage what was happening on the street? They weren't, and it was awful service. The agency was broken. And so now they're held accountable for their on-time performance, for their safety, for all the things that, a normal business or a normal transit system would do or should do. So we're being recognized now across the country, across the world. We've increased our on-time performance for all those six modes by 10 to 15 points. We are now some of the... our modes are some of the best in America. Our paratransit service is running 95% on time. When I got there, it was like 83. We had a lawsuit against us. It was running so bad. Our subway system runs 99% on time. Our light rail system runs 97% on time. So we're making dramatic improvements using standard management practices. We've greatly improved our service for the Ravens. We do light rail service for them and for the Orioles and all the things there. I did want to point out to you what we also are doing for Queen Anne's County and a few other things to tell you about. We just started a brand new route that I have some brochures over there for you. It's called Commuter Bus Route 210. This goes from Kent Island to Annapolis and then to Baltimore. It's a brand new commuter service. It costs $6 to ride to Baltimore one way, $6 back, $12. You know, parking in Baltimore is $20, not to count your gas and the toll and all that. So this is a brand new commuter service. It's run with motor coaches. By the way, we outsource a lot of what we do. I'm a strong believer that when it makes sense, you should look at that. So we outsource all of our MARC commuter train service. That's to Amtrak and to Bombardier. Our paratransit service for the people with disabilities, that's all outsourced to three private companies. And our commuter bus service is outsourced to seven motor coach companies. So they use the nice plush motor coaches with Wi-Fi and bathrooms and all that. It's a long haul, you know, to drive a long way instead of a city bus. So I'd encourage you, if you know anybody that needs this, we pick up at 5:30 a.m., 6:30 a.m., and 7:30 a.m. at the Castle Marina Park and Ride right next to Western Auto. And then we leave right there and go down to the Kmart Park and Ride, the Stevensville Park and Ride, and we take off from there and go to Annapolis, a stop at the mall where you can transfer to Annapolis Transit. I've timed it. The mayor and I timed it so we can ride his service around the city, or you can go up to Baltimore City. You don't have to go there for work. You could go there to shop or hang out in the Inner Harbor this summer for 5 or 6 hours and then get back in the bus and come back. So that's a brand new service we're offering. Just started that a couple months ago. I also want to let you know that if you're going to the Orioles game, a good way to get there is to ride to our Cromwell Light Rail Station. Get on the light rail. That way you don't have to mess with parking when you get into Baltimore City. It drops you off right at the warehouse, and you walk right into the stadium. So I've got brochures about that there. We also have two other commuter services that run to Washington, D.C. every day. If you're going to D.C., these ones are almost full, but there are room left on them. That's Route 240 and 250 from underneath the Kent Narrows Bridge is the first stop, and then down at Kmart. The schedules are right over there. Also want to tell you that we are hiring at the MTA, and we're not just hiring from just, you don't have to live in Baltimore City. I've got 15 police jobs open. I have a police force of 185 police officers. By the way, for the last 2 years, we've been the safest public transit system in America. We have the lowest number of Part 1 crimes out of any of the major top 12 transit systems. So we're really proud of that. I got a great police chief, great police force. We take a lot of pride in that. I've been able to add 20 new officers by reallocating pins, and Governor Hogan gave me 10 more positions. So if you know anybody who wants to be a police officer, please, we're desperately looking. We have 15 openings. We pay you to go to the academy for 6 months to become a certified officer. You get paid $35,000 a year. Break that into your biweekly check. And then when you graduate, you make $43,000. That's the starting pay for an MTA police officer. You would work in downtown Baltimore most of the time, but there's recruitment brochures there. So I'd encourage you, if you know anyone, or if you already are a police officer and you want to transfer, we have a transfer rate as well, but we'll bring you over. We also have tons of other jobs, and so I wanted to tell you about them. I'm not going to tell you all about them, but there's a list right there, and the website that you go to apply. We're looking for quality people for some great, I mean, these are state government jobs. They've got great pay, great benefits. Lastly, what we're doing for a county right here in Queen Anne's County. So I want to let you know that the government uses something called fiscal years. All that means is it's not a calendar year, it's a budget year. It starts July 1st. County and the state use the same fiscal year. The federal government starts in October, we start in July. So we give Queen Anne's County this year $438,126 to run County Ride and to run the elderly and disabled transportation called SSTAP, State Special Transportation Assistance Program. We also provided a grant to the county of $58,000 to do preventive maintenance, $18,000 for a bus canopy, and then $90,000 for the county to do a transportation development plan to look at what County Ride should look like over the next few years. So all in $166,000 in capital and $438,000 in operating. For the coming fiscal year, the budget that I proposed to the General Assembly that was adopted, and the governor proposed it, was the same amount for operating dollars, $438,000. But we're also adding in $63,000 for preventive maintenance and two extra buses for the system, is what Commissioner Rand was talking about, $120,708. plus wrapping up the bus canopy of $64,000 and some computers for the county ride system for a total of $256,000 or $110,000 more than you got last year from the MTA. We funnel a lot of that as federal dollars, and then we add in state dollars, and then the local government sometimes gives a match to help match that to make that happen. And we also provide $156,000 this year for the Kent Center, who also provide services that come some into Queen Anne's County. We help them buy three buses. So we provide, in addition to the six services that we operate, we take $100 million of federal and state money and distribute it to all 23 counties in Maryland to help them run their version of County Ride. In Montgomery County, it's called Ride On. In Prince George's County, it's called The Bus. And there's Midshore Transit. Now, we give them money, and we also provide capital dollars to them to help buy vehicles. And we give $50 million or thereabouts to nonprofit agencies across the state of Maryland, like adult daycare centers, like somebody like a Chester Y or a group like that, that if they need a vehicle, we'll help fund that vehicle. It's a competitive process. They have to apply, they have to win the grant, but these are all dollars that are coming mostly from the federal government that is providing money for transit across Maryland. So that's a look for you at what we're a part of as part of the Maryland state government and how the MTA operates, not only as the transit system for Baltimore, but also for each county in Maryland. We try to provide them assistance.